It's great to see everyone. I actually can't see you because there's a light in my eyes, but it's great to have you all here. Before we get started, there's a few people I just want to acknowledge and say thank you to. Mary Tilde and Cindy Noble of the Council led a great planning effort with the California Council and the Shasta Trinity Cascades chapter. Did just a great job. Thank you all so much for your work. A special shout out to one of our great TU businesses, the Fly Shop. Mike and Bertha Michalak had hosted an event for us on Wednesday evening, and then Michael Carancy, the chapter president, led a great fishing day. I saw more big fish pictures from this fishing day than I think I've ever seen at Trout Unlimited. So thank you as well. We've got a few people that I would be remiss not to acknowledge. We've got a number of the National Board of Trustees here. Could you all stand and let us thank you for your service? And then I know we have a good number of staff that are here. If the staff would also stand and allow everyone to acknowledge your great contributions. I hope you will take the time to, if you don't know the staff or even the trustees, with the exception of Dan, they're all very approachable people. But please do interact with them. There's just some great folks who make some amazing contributions to TU, including Dan, and our mission. Reading, as everyone knows, has had a really, really difficult summer. The Carr Fire and several other fire complexes burnt over 1,000 homes in the community. The Shasta Regional Community Foundation is leading the relief effort, and this is their donation page. I went online this morning and made a donation. It's very easy to do. You know, we are very, very focused on community in this organization, and this is a community that's had a really hard time. And to the extent you're able, I would encourage you to go to this site and make a donation if you can. So one of the great benefits of my job is that I get to talk with TU people on a daily basis, and I never really know what's going to come over the transom. It could be something hostile about how often we're mailing people, or it could be a compliment. But I had a great call earlier this year from a man named Ben Pinty, and he lives in Pennsylvania now, but in the context of resolving whatever the issue was that he called about, we got into this conversation, and he shared with me how he got involved in Trout Unlimited and how he got involved in conservation. And he wrote, "Growing up in Bridgeport, West Virginia, with my six brothers and sisters, we had an income that would qualify as poverty level. Still, my dad always found a way to take his sons trout fishing in the nearby mountains. Near my home was a local smallmouth stream that coal mining destroyed. It was ruined before I was old enough to fish it, and I felt cheated out of something that should have been available to a poor kid growing up in Appalachia. I went to college, and the first dollar I ever spent on an environmental organization was with TU. A dollar was tough to come by before my first good job. TU molded me to be a lifelong conservationist and one who has great concern for our world. I hope that groups like TU will help others, as it helped me, to learn to respect the environment. Our survival, trout fishing including, depends on it." So when I received or had this correspondence with Ben, I was reading a book by Ken McKee called Story. And in the book, McKee sort of bemoans the loss of storytelling in America. And he writes, and I promise I'm not just going to read quotes to you all morning, "Story shapes a perception of what's worth living for, worth dying for, what's foolish to pursue, the meaning of justice, truth, the essential values. The erosion of values in our country has brought with it a corresponding erosion of story." And so what I'd like to do today is reflect on the fact that Ken McKee clearly was not a Trout Unlimited member, because one of the great things about this organization is how full of stories we are, stories that give hope, stories that offer solutions. And today what I'd like to do in my presentation, in the context of talking about all of the amazing work of the organization over the course of the year, is ask and answer this question: how can we inspire more stories? At the national level, the story is quite good. The organization is very strong, we're very healthy right now. You can see the scope and scale of our work reflected on the left. These numbers get bigger and bigger every year as we grow. But the work is only made possible because of those wonderful staff that stood up earlier, and you. For the fourth year in a row, you broke your previous record for the numbers of hours that you donate in service to the communities that you live and love and fish in. TU chapters donated more than 700,000 hours to those communities. It's an awesome accomplishment. And that accomplishment allows us to accomplish or to get so much work done on the ground. Now, in terms of inspiring more conservation stories, it's good to start early. Not everyone has the path to conservation that I had. I grew up playing sports, and hunting and fishing was not a part of my life. I had this Saul on the road to Damascus moment when I went to Alaska and I discovered these awesome creatures called salmon. And that put me, that epiphany sort of put me on the path to conservation. But what we do at Trout Unlimited is we try to reach children at a very young age when they're in, you know, grammar school. And then we stay with them all the way through college. And we have this thing we call the stream of engagement. And it provides an opportunity for kids to have this experiential learning in nature throughout their whole life. I want to just give a shout out here to the Guadalupe River chapter of TU, whose Tomorrow Fund is based on helping to finance a lot of that work. Guadalupe chapter is such a special chapter to me. We're going to celebrate a lot of really cool things that the chapters are doing to make the places that they love to fish better. What makes GRTU so special is they're giving to places like they've supported our efforts to protect Bristol Bay, this Tomorrow Fund they've supported. They've supported other restoration work in places that they never probably will ever fish. So just a huge thank you to GRTU and for your support of the Tomorrow Fund. Because, yes. The Tomorrow Fund makes possible programs like Trout in the Classroom. You all know about this program. We go into school systems. We put tanks in there. Kids learn about the life cycle of trout. They learn about the water cycle. They learn about conservation. It's especially strong in New York City. We're now in all the boroughs of the city. We have over 100 different Trout in the Classroom programs in the city. And it's just vitally important that these kids, many of whom live in urban environments and rarely get out beyond a park perhaps, understand where their water is coming from. And Trout in the Classroom helps them to do that. One of the things I think that has just been a hallmark of this organization is the awesome effort our chapters and councils put into youth camps. We have now, I think, 27 or 28 of these different youth camps all around the country. And then we, through a competitive application process, we ask those teenagers to apply to come to a teen summit. And this year's teen summit was at Graves Mountain Lodge in Virginia. The oddly doughy looking guy right there is me. I had the pleasure of spending a day with these kids, and I remember the first thing I thought when I walked into the room was, I was thinking of my own children, and I thought, you know, what happens if you get a shy kid, right? Who, you know, none of these kids know each other. They come from all over the country. And I asked the question, and they showed me this piece of paper on the wall. And what makes Franklin and his team's work so great is they don't write the rules. They have the kids write the ground rules at the start of the meeting. And one of the rules that the kids, the first rule that the kids had written was, no one gets left alone. And so that if they saw a wallflower or someone who was sort of hanging on the side, the first thing they would do is go and engage him and bring him into the conversation. And so we were seated in this big circle, and I was answering these questions, and it was hard. I mean, some of the questions were really tough. They asked me about one kid asked me about the hydrologic cycle, and I had to explain that I'm a political science major. Another kid asked me about the importance of small streams. A third asked me about how do you get conservation done in such a politically divided atmosphere. And after the meeting was over, just a great experience, after the meeting was over, Lisa Baranek, one of our wonderful volunteer operations staff who was there to help out, She turned to me and said, you know, those kids who asked you those questions, the really tough questions, those were the wallflowers. Those were the kids who that we were worried about not being engaged. So our hope is that those leaders of the Teen Summit, they take that experience on that they've learned over that several-day period, and then they go on to college and university, and they become members of the Five Rivers program. This is a relatively new program, but we have more than 100 schools that participate in the Five Rivers program. We have over 3,000 college students who are helping to fulfill their community service requirements, their service learning requirements that are a part of their degree, by giving back through Trout Unlimited. And our great friends at Costa Del Mar, who sponsor this program, have set up these summits in the East and in the West, where we can bring the leaders together of these programs. And they have a great time. I mean, they're college kids. There's a lot of fishing, and there's a lot of like fly tying marathons, but there's also a ton of leadership development that's occurring there. We're making a really large impact on these kids, young men and women, at a very important, very formative part of their lives. The luckiest of those 3,000 get to go on the Native Trout Odyssey. So we had four kids this year, four young adults, I should say, who went to Alaska for 5 weeks, and they toured the Kenai Peninsula, the Tongass National Forest, and then they went to Bristol Bay. And last year's, I spent time with the graduates of last year's Native Trout Odyssey, and it was wonderful. And what I came away with, though, was that we had subsidized probably the best four-week fishing trip of their life across public lands. This year was totally different. They gave me a presentation, I think it was this past Monday. They were in Washington. They went and they met with their members of Congress. They talked about these Alaska issues. They talked about what they learned in Alaska. They went and they briefed our friends at the Forest Service, who also helped us support that work. And when they made their presentation to me, and I don't think they were shining me on, probably 70% of what they presented was what they learned about conservation. And the young woman you see here, Kylie, she actually shared with me something I didn't know, that for every two adult, it takes 3,000 salmon eggs to produce two adult salmon. And she said that she was so taken by this experience that she had in Alaska that next year, she's a student teacher now, next year when she graduates, she's gonna move from Pennsylvania and become an environmental educator in Alaska. So the best stories come from the places that we know and love the best. And we have this really interesting phenomena that's occurring right now across the organization, and I find it incredibly heartening. So last year, or 2 years ago, the Jackson Hole chapter came to us and said, we'd like to finance half of a position, if you can fundraise and finance the rest, to go and help restore the headwaters of the Snake River system. So we're talking about some of these fabled rivers like the Hoback and the Gros Ventre, the Salt. And we hired Leslie Steen, and she is now busy working to do just that. She's got incredible projects planned across the range to maintain what is arguably the finest native trout fishery in the lower 48. I know I'll probably hear from some of you from Idaho or Montana, but this is just a remarkable fishery, and we're doing everything we can to keep it intact. Well, word of that must have spread over to Montana, because the West Slope chapter approached us this year and said, we like that model. What if we provided half of the salary for someone for you all to oversee and engage them doing the same kind of restoration work on the fabled Rock Creek? And I called our chapter president there, a man named Mark Kuipers, the other day, and I asked him, so what prompted this? And he said, you know, 10 years ago, we'd be thrilled if we had a banquet and we raised $5,000. And then 5 years ago, we raised $35,000. And then the next year, we raised $75,000. And this year, we raised $120,000 at their banquet. And they said, we want to give back. We want to make sure that we keep Rock Creek the amazing fishery that it is. Well, the Madison-Gallatin chapter, a very competitive chapter, and by the way, we did. We hired Jess Scanlon to lead a restoration effort here on Rock Creek. Well, the Madison-Gallatin chapter, another awesome chapter in TU, they caught wind of that, and they approached us and said, well, we want to do the same thing on the headwaters of the Yellowstone in the Missouri system. So we now have another TU staffer in the state of Montana working on recovering those home rivers as well. In 1969 in New Hampshire, there was a devastating, what the scientists say was probably a 500-year flood event that barreled through Nash Stream and really destroyed an already heavily impacted river system. Nash Stream is one of these streams where they used to do splash dam logging, where they would log and bring the logs down to the river's edge and then build a dam. And then when the water rose, they'd blow the dam and float the logs down the river. It's a somewhat destructive practice. We don't do that anymore. So this was already a heavily impacted system. And 15 years ago, the New Hampshire Council came to us and said, look, we want to start to try to bring this river back. Right? This is was historically a really important brook trout fishery. We want to bring it back. So for 15 years, we did what we do best. We worked on building partnerships with the state and federal agencies, bringing in private landowners, bringing in other conservation interests. And we did a lot of these projects, like the one you see here, where we brought the large wood component back into the creek, because these creeks had, when they cut all the riparian areas, there were no trees to fall into the creeks, to slow the creek down, to provide cover, and so on. And I'm pleased to report that historically, the state would stock Nash Stream with about 6,000 trout every year. They're not doing it this year, because the native trout have come back to the point that they no longer need to stock. We have a multifaceted commitment to the Delaware Basin. We now have 7 staff working in the basin on a variety of different topics. In the headwaters, we're working to help reconnect important spawning and rearing habitat for fish. And this year and next year, we will have put together about 18 miles of habitat that were previously disconnected from rivers like the Beaverkill and the Willow-Weemock. These are the birthplace of modern dry fly fishing in the eastern United States. Further up in the basin, in the upper Delaware, thanks to the commitment of people like Garth Pettinger and Lee Hartman, we have been working for years on trying to fix the flow situation on the upper Delaware. I'm not going to get into the details because it's quite arcane, but there's a Supreme Court case from 1954 that regulates how flow in the river works. And the parties, the decree parties, the relevant states and the city of New York, have to come to an accord on how that works. Well, we came within days last year of that accord expiring. And what would have happened then is the river would have returned to management, a management paradigm of like 30 years ago, where they weren't providing any flows for fish. And it was awesome to see TU mobilize, along with our friends at the Friends of the Upper Delaware River group. We did, and I did an op-ed in the Newark Star-Ledger. My colleague Jeff Skelding did one in the New York Times. Our chapters met. We wrote to our governors. And eventually, that pressure brought the decree parties back to the table, and they signed a new 10-year accord that gives us about the same sort of protection as we had before, but it builds in some flexibility for us to make it better, to actually improve ecological stream flows in the Upper Delaware Basin. At the same time, our chapters have been really active in supporting a prohibition on the practice of fracking in the upper Delaware. This is the drinking water supply for New York City, and we want to make sure that it stays cold, clean, and healthy. The newest part of the Delaware program is in the great state of New Jersey. So in New Jersey, we've had a long-standing partnership with the State Fish and Wildlife Agency, just great, great people there. And their commitment to native trout restoration is epic. There are native brook trout in New Jersey. And this year, in some of the key tributaries to the Delaware, we're going to be reintroducing heritage strain native brook trout to about 15 of those watersheds, and or 15 of those rivers, I should say. The person that does that work for us is a young man by the name of Cole Baldino. And I am going to embarrass him now by reading his cover letter that he sent to Keith Curley when he was applying for a job with us. I'll embarrass him more in a minute, but. Dear Mr. Curley, at the age of 8, I spent two hours, countless fly changes, leader adjustments, and utter frustration to finally entice a feeding trout to my size 22 blue-winged olive. My first 18-inch wild brown was hooked, and I knew I had found the passion I would follow for the rest of my life. I am eager to invest myself into a company that shares the same passion toward bettering cold, clean, and connected watersheds abundant with wild trout. My goal, my future goal, is to combine passion, knowledge, and experience to remove thousands of obsolete culverts and dams throughout the United States. So we're helping Cole to fulfill his life's passion, which is awesome. I have a personal appreciation for that. Cole lives with another TU staff person named Rob Shane, and their apartment is noticeable because when you walk in the living room table, or rather the dining room table, what would be the dining room table, is just covered 100% with fly tying material. And what makes their patterns, like this Delaware mouse, so effective is they use native material. So they trap the mice that I imagine are fairly prevalent in their kitchen, and then they use that to tie remarkably realistic flies. I haven't had the courage yet to tell Cole and Rob about the bubonic plague and its causes, but... So great stories, they teach and they educate and they create opportunity. Last year, or 2 years ago, I guess, the Hewlett Foundation, in partnership with the Resources Legacy Fund, came up with a $50 million dam removal program. So they've made this $50 million investment in the removal of obsolete and unnecessary dams. And we've got about four or five of these projects that you're going to be hearing about in the coming year or two. But this year, we managed to take that mess out of the river on the East Fork of the Wind in Wyoming. That's basically a bunch of, looks like, you know, 2x8s that are strung across the water with tarp on them, and it diverts the flow of the stream into an irrigation ditch. We managed to take that out and replace it with that more modern irrigation system on the right. So that work helped to open up 18 miles of habitat for cutthroat that otherwise was inaccessible. Equally important, it saves about 150 acre-feet of water. And in a small mountain stream like this, that's a significant addition of water. This is a great story. So the Fish and Wildlife Service was looking at listing for protection under the Endangered Species Act this unique form of rainbow trout that finds its habitat in Eagle Lake, the Eagle Lake rainbow trout. We were working in partnership with a variety of others, and the Fish and Wildlife Service decided to delay the listing based on the promise of the work that we were doing. So what we did is we set about to recover these meadows that feed into a place called Pine Creek. And based on that meadow restoration, which, you know, and you know how meadows work, right? Meadows absorb and hold water. They're like a sponge on the landscape. And so when you can restore your meadow systems, you can raise the water table. And what had happened was, because of the degradation of the meadows and drought and everything else, the river level had dropped to the point that it was disconnected from Eagle Lake. And based on that meadow restoration, we were able to double the base flow in Pine Creek such that adfluvial populations of these big rainbows that live in the lake are now able to spawn in Pine Creek. And the Fish and Wildlife Service decided not to list the Eagle Lake rainbow trout under the Endangered Species Act. In 2008, steelhead in the Skagit River were listed under the Endangered Species Act. The Skagit flows into Puget Sound. In 2009, they closed the fishery down. We did what we do, and we advocated for wild fish. Finally, in 2014, they stopped stocking in the river, and we did our typical suite of habitat restoration. Now, the fish, what they're looking for is an escapement goal of about 6,000 fish from the Skagit. And we had about 2,500. We were at about 2,500 when they listed the fish. So a far cry from where we needed to be. Well, last year we had 9,000 fish come into the system. And for the first time in about a decade, the Fish and Wildlife Service in the state opened up the fishery again for steelhead fishing. And I'll tell you why this is important. It's not just because steelheaders are nuts, who love to fish for steelheads. They're totally passionate about it. It's because steelheading has become a really important economic driver in some of these rural communities. These are all former timber-dependent towns, and the timber economy has been way down for a long time. And so they need that economic shot in the arm that steelheaders bring when they come and they stay in motels and they buy gas and they buy dinners. And I had a conversation about that with the mayor of Darrington, Washington, Nick Chambers, who works on the Wild Steelhead Initiative, made an introduction for me. And I just want to share with you what he said. I found it remarkable. He said, conservation in rural communities means the wise use of natural resources. Rural people are too often considered bad actors. Most of us do not feel that those accusations are justified. Until our society starts to take responsibility for all of our impacts, little will change. We all have a hand in the demise of these places and fisheries, but we can also play a role in their recovery. The steelhead are like the members of my community. They are resilient. Give them half a chance, and they will come back. So when I first started working at Trout Unlimited, we had this very sort of machismo sense of the organization. And we used to talk about how we wanted to own issues. We were going to own organizing hunters and anglers. We were going to own Western water. We were going to own habitat restoration. We've had about a 180-degree change in direction on that thought, because we realize that as long as we own the issue, then we're never going to be able to accomplish our vision. If we get other people to own our issues, we can. And so a great example of that is happening in Pennsylvania. This is a typical habitat improvement project in the Schuylkill, the headwaters of the Schuylkill in Pennsylvania. We actually did not do this project. This was designed by one of our staff people named Phil Thomas, and he did the planning for it, and then he handed it off to a watershed organization. This tech transfer concept is one that we've started exploring more and more in Pennsylvania, because there's dozens of watershed groups and other great conservation interests all across the Commonwealth. And because of this approach last year, we were able, through projects like this, now we didn't do the work, right? We didn't make the light bulb, we just helped it burn brighter. But because of the design and the planning and the engineering work we did that others then executed, we had a hand in reconnecting over 100 miles of habitat in Pennsylvania. We worked on about 50 different acid mine drainage projects that others are executing, and other various habitat restoration projects. It's a great, great role, model for the future. So I think it goes without saying that the work of Trout Unlimited helps to build community. And one of the best examples of that is our veteran service partnership. We have now about 200 chapters that are participating in veteran service partnership outreach. The picture that you see here are of a couple named Ashley and Ben Mellon. They went on this recent couples trip that we hold at Silvertip, which is an exclusive, it's a private in-holding, it's a real destination fishery, it's really hard to get there. It's 10 miles in into Yellowstone. You have to go in by horseback or hike. And Ashley represents, I think, an important turning point in the Veteran Service Partnership. See, when we started this program, the idea was, let's give something back, right? Let's give something back to these people who have given so much to the nation. Let's see if fishing and time on the water can be an effective therapy for things like PTSD and help, you know, profoundly physically injured warriors to rediscover the love of fishing. And then we'll welcome them into our chapters. That was the idea. It was very basic. What's happening now is that these are purpose-driven people, right? These are mission-driven people. And so Ashley came into the organization. She got a free TU membership through one of the VSP programs. And she immediately began volunteering. She started doing conservation projects. She got involved in education work. Soon she was on the board of the Clinch River chapter in Tennessee. The day I talked to her, her husband, Ben, was supposed to be voted onto the board. And all across the country, this is happening more and more. Veterans are coming to TU for the fishing experience, and they're staying for the sense of mission and purpose that we offer. And that is really good for us, and it's really good for them. This is one of my favorite stories. So several years ago, Nick Streeter, let me go back a second. The Red River, like so many rivers in the West, has a Superfund site in its headwaters. There was a big molybdenum mine that they had problems with. They turned it into a Superfund site. Downstream is the community of Cuesta, small, mostly Hispanic community, a couple thousand people maybe. Well, Nick Streeter owns a business there called the Taos Fly Shop. He's one of our great TU business members. And he was at one of these Superfund hearings, and he heard one of the government experts say, well, we've really fixed the water quality, but man, the habitat's trashed. And so Nick, who was the chapter president of the Enchanted Circle chapter, said, well, I want to do something about that. So He, the chapter, raised $5,000 to do habitat restoration. He picked up the phone and called his buddy Toner Mitchell, who was the president of the Truchis chapter, and they contributed $5,000. We then doubled that with an Embrace the Stream grant. The state got very excited about the work, and pretty soon they were sitting on $500,000 to do habitat restoration. So they turned sections of the river that looked like this, that's an irrigation diversion, obviously not passable for fish, into this. They did about 2 miles of this kind of work on the Red River, creating habitat, still allowing the irrigator to divert water. It's a very agricultural community. In the meantime, Nick was so taken with this work and with, you know, the art of the possible that he became the primary advocate, one of the primary advocates, for creation of the Rio Grande del Norte National Monument, which was proclaimed by President Obama several years ago. It protects like 50-something miles of just a great wild trout fishery. Meantime, we hire Toner. Trout Unlimited hires Toner to come work for us. Toner has this vision of making the Red River into a destination fishery, and the community of Cuesta into a gateway community for people who will come to see the monument and fish the monument. So it's working. And the reason we know it's working is last year, every year, the New Mexico Department of Fish and Game, they gather a bunch of volunteers who then go into the canyon to stock Rio Grande cutthroat trout. Last year, they had about 30 people come. This year, they had about 400 show up. 400 people in a tiny little town of Cuesta. So the idea behind this is these are what we used to call resource-dependent communities. And what we're doing is helping them to, and they were reliant on commodity products, wood fiber, forage, minerals. And what we're helping them to understand is that they can still be resource-dependent communities, but the resource is the river that flows through their community. And if we can get communities like Cuesta to take ownership of the restoration and recovery of their river systems because it drives economic opportunity, we'll spurn more and more of that growth around the country. The Upper Colorado is a story that you've heard before. We were engaged in a pitched battle for 10, 15 years with Northern Water and Denver Water, who wanted to take water from the headwaters from the Upper Colorado and divert it over to the Front Range for municipal purposes. This was just an epic David against Goliath fight. But shockingly, several years ago, we actually reached an accord with them. And we agreed that they can take a certain amount of water, provided that they provide a bypass around this place called Windy Gap Reservoir, which was a thermal barrier for trout because it's a wide, shallow reservoir with warm water. And then they also agreed to commit to $6 million worth of habitat restoration for the 30 miles downstream of Windy Gap. Our great friends at the Upper Colorado River Alliance and we have raised 10 of the $14 million that we need for that bypass. We will raise the rest of it probably this year and get that done. And they've got this really cool concept that they call learning by doing. So they've reserved this additional increment of water that can be kept and used in low-flow situations so we don't have dry streams in drought conditions. That's the story that you've heard before. But the really cool new development is the relationship and the partnership that we formed with a lot of these irrigators in the Upper Basin, a lot of these agricultural landowners. And I just want to share with you a brief video that describes that.
We're out on the river, we're fishing, we're having a great morning, everything was fantastic. It was legitimately an amazing morning of fishing. We had cloud cover and everything aligned and things were perfect. And just after the middle of the day, we were in the river and things started dropping to a very, it was very noticeable. I mean, it was something that was occurring. We were there and we're standing there and I was looking at these guys and at first it's like, all right, you know, we got to move back to the pools. Let's go focus, fish are going to be. And I kept watching the river as it was dropping and I looked at these people and I said, I apologize, but I need to get on the phone right now. This our river's drying up. It was a reckoning of times. We realized hard and fast that while we have some amazing, wonderful water rights in the Colorado River, that didn't necessarily mean very much. And that was a scary day. And it was a moment that we knew that if we did not take action, and that could be the future of our river, that not only did we not have a river, but we didn't have a ranch.
It's a great film. That's the teaser for it. I'd encourage you to look for it. It's called A River's Reckoning. More great work by our man Josh Duplichane. One of the things that I think is, one of the stories that I think we don't tell enough at TU is how important science is to the organization and how important science is to the country. State and federal agencies aren't making the basic investments in science that they used to. As their budgets are either cut or held flat, they just don't have the capacity to do that work. So more and more, TU is becoming the agent that brings new scientific ideas to our wonderful state and federal agency partners. It's a great depoliticizer, and it's really important work. For example, this is a Lahontan cutthroat trout. So Lahontan cutthroat trout occupy less than 1% of their historic lake habitat. So we used to get these big adfluvial fish that would live in the lake and then spawn in the river systems. They've lost more than 99% of their habitat. One of the two lakes that they remain is in Summit Lake, Nevada. Now, I'm sure you're all familiar with those pictures of the guys who bring the stepladders out to Pyramid Lake and fish for those big cutthroat or the big Lahontans that cruise around. Those are hatchery fish. These are native fish. And what one of our wonderful scientists, Renee from the California office, did is he went down and worked with a band of the Paiute tribe there. Their name actually translates to fish eaters. These are fish that are hugely culturally important to the tribe. And working with the University of Reno, Nevada, they came up with a series of monitoring protocols that the tribal biologists could use to begin to plan for a restoration and otherwise understand what the management needs of these fish are. That work happens all across the western United States today, and the east for that matter. So Lahontan cutthroat trout are a listed species. They're threatened under the Endangered Species Act. Again, our friends in this case, California Department of Fish and Wildlife, don't necessarily have the resources to go out and do the monitoring in the inventory work that needs to be done to better inform recovery actions. So Jason Barnes leads a crew of people that does that for the state in a scientifically valid manner, and then we give that data to the state so they can make better decisions about bringing these fish back. Across the east, we had always known that southern Appalachian brook trout were special, and there was something unique about them. We had also known that one of the limiting factors to their persistence was that they live in these isolated patches. They're very fragmented. We thought there were about 1,200 of these patches. Our science team went back and took a look and created this brook trout atlas, and we realized there aren't 1,200 patches, there's 10,000 of them. When I first heard that news, when Keith told me this, I thought, wow, that's great. That's 8 or 9 times better. And he said, no, man, it's backwards. What it means is that these populations are even more fragmented than we thought, so they're even more isolated. The good news to this bad news story is that USGS went out and did some genetic testing, and they found out that there's not a single unique strain of Appalachian brook trout. There's dozens of unique strains of them. They're incredibly genetically diverse. And it is a truism in nature that diversity breeds strength. And so I'm happy to let all of you know, from the Southeast in particular, that Beverly's working very hard with Keith and others to hire a Southeast coordinator. And one of their jobs will be to help try to put projects together, working with our chapters, that reconnect these brook trout populations, that get those genes mixing, that build resilience in these populations. Another priority that this person will have is also working with the chapters and other partners in the Southeast to help extend the cold water influence of our wonderful tailwater fisheries in the region. This is a new development. This just came across my transom yesterday, and I added it to the presentation. Rush Creek flows into Mono Lake here in California, and for a long time it was sort of a well-kept secret that it had one of the best wild brown trout fisheries in the state. Unfortunately, in recent years, word got out about that, and the fishery began to go into decline. And so the Mono Lake Fisheries Commission approached Trout Unlimited, they approached Jessica Strickland, and said, hey, would you work with some partners and put together a review of what's going on with these fish and then make some recommendations to us? Jessica did her work, she did her inventorying, did her monitoring, did the sampling, creel surveys, talked to anglers, and the recommendation was that during the fall spawning season, we ought to fish to these fish, there ought to be no catch and release, single fly, no bait only regulations put in place. Now, it's not done yet. The Fisheries Commission is still reviewing the findings, but we feel very confident that this good information, this good science will lead to a good decision because anglers seem to broadly support it. So over the past maybe 8 to 10 years, we have put a pronounced emphasis on this idea of going into these important watersheds and correcting the slights of the past, right? Our rivers in this country have been beset by the death of 1,000 cuts. And when you layer on top of that the increasing floods, fire, and drought, they can't take it. They just can't take it. So what we're doing is going back and through all the work, all that restoration work that we've been talking about and I'll continue to talk about here, we're helping to recover the resiliency of these rivers so they're better able to withstand those big natural events, which are becoming all the more common. A great example of that is on the Blackfoot in Idaho. So the Blackfoot was formerly a stronghold for Yellowstone cutthroat trout. And because of past grazing management practices, much of the habitat looked like that picture on the left, just kind of a bombed out lunar landscape. No features to the habitat, deeply incised channels. When it rains, the river just runs through and then it's gone. So we began this really innovative partnership with a series of mining companies and a conservation group, the Idaho Conservation League. And Matt Woodard was describing to me how he works with the mining companies. And he said, well, I'll give you an example of how it works. They wanted to do a mine expansion, and they had to cut a bunch of trees to do the expansion. And I said, no, don't cut the trees. Use your big equipment. And this is a phosphate mine, so I don't know if you've seen phosphate mines. Their equipment is really, really big. But use some of your big equipment and just knock those trees over and keep the root wads on. And they did that. And then they used the equipment to transport the root wads back to the creek where Matt and our partners, you know, interlaced the wood, created good complexity in the habitat. That slows the water down, provides holding cover, promotes pools, and et cetera. They had to raise the creek bed, in some cases, 4 feet. It had been so deeply incised by cows and by the flows of water just shooting through. And one of the ways they did that was they were able to use big machinery to grab these whole clumps of willows. This isn't the, you know, willow planting that I've been a part of where you take a piece of rebar and you hammer it in the ground, you stick a stake. This is using big equipment, grabbing big chunks of willows and then bringing them over live and planting them. And you can see the result on the right. This is a before and after shot, believe it or not. Matt's now done about 25 miles of this kind of restoration and reconnection work on tributaries such as Upper Lanes Creek, to the point that we now have adfluvial populations of Yellowstone cutthroat that migrate from the reservoir down to the larger rivers. We have fluvial populations that live in the larger rivers and migrate to the smaller streams to spawn, and then we have resident populations. So maintaining that life history diversity is what will keep these populations healthy for a very long time. So in a couple years ago, in 2016, there was some devastating flooding on the coast of Oregon. And in Tillamook County, they spent upwards of at least $10 million just to recover the lost road infrastructure. And that prompted Trout Unlimited, people like Terry Turner, who won our Distinguished Service Conservation Award yesterday, to approach Tillamook County and to approach the state and our other federal partners and say, listen, what if we created something called the Salmon Superhighway? Because we have fish, anadromous fish, that migrate from the ocean through those same that same infrastructure that's being blown out every year because it looks like that, right? And when the flood comes, not only are fish not going to be able to pass through here typically, but when the flood comes, it's not just going to take that pipe. It's going to take the road above the pipe too. And so we formed the Salmon Superhighway. And we've been able to do projects such as this where we replace a culvert with a bridge to the extent that we've now done about 68 miles of projects like that. It's a great way of demonstrating that you can meet the needs of people while also meeting the needs of nature. In fact, they go hand in hand, and this is just a wonderful demonstration of that. And we've got, again, a great partnership formed there, and I'd be remiss not to call out one of my favorite TU partners, the Pelican Brewing Company, another TU business member who have been just a great supporter and promoter of this work. For 15 years, we've been working with the Lolo National Forest and the County of Missoula on Nine Mile Creek. To date, we've cleaned up, I think it's a dozen abandoned mines. I think we've got two left. We've reconnected eight separate tributaries that had been historically disconnected. This is a tributary to the Upper Clark Fork. And we've recreated, literally rebuilt, and I'll show you a little video of this in a second, 2 miles of stream. And a few years ago, or actually it was just last year, Paul Parsons, who is our project coordinator in the area, and his contractor, Darren Haskins, came to my house for dinner. They were in Washington to receive an award, and it was just awesome talking to Darren. You know, he's a heavy equipment operator, and he was like a kid. He was gleeful talking about this restoration work. And so I asked him, how did you get into this? And he sort of glibly answered, well, when I was a kid in a sandbox. But the real story is he was an excavator, and he was doing a lot of residential work and a little bit of commercial work. And Rob Roberts, who started this project, called and asked him to haul some rock one day. And he was out in the woods, and again, Superior, Montana, it's another former timber-dependent community. They've got two mills that have been shut down in Superior. He said, wow, this is a great way for me to get out in the woods and make a living. So he flew himself back to Asheville, North Carolina, where he took Rosgen training, and that's the natural stream dynamic training that's sort of all the rage. Dave Rosgen pioneered. And he's now our lead excavator on this project, and we've been at it for a long time, and you'll see the results in a second. But I said to him, so what's the upshot? I mean, what do the people in the community think? I mean, do they think you're a communist because you're associating with us? And he said, no, he said, this really cool thing has happened. They come now to me so that the loggers will come to me. They see what we did on 9 Mile. They see how good it looks. And he talks about how, you know, underneath every hole, there's a fish. And every kid knows that. And every kid in Superior is fishing those holes. But he said, now these loggers, they come to him and say, instead of going in there and doing what the Forest Service tells us, which they should do, tell us what we can do to make the rivers look like that river. And so we're working. They come to Paul, they come to Rob, they come to Darren, and they've changed the conversation is what they've done. So the conversation used to be about how can I get as much as I can, how can I take as much value from the woods as I can, to now it's how much more can I put in value to the woods while taking out enough to keep my community resilient. It's a tremendous change in thinking that this kind of restoration work and these stories help to inspire.
In all reality, this is actually a pretty messed up ecosystem. What we're looking at here is an abandoned placer mine. In a stream system like this, we would never see a straightened channel naturally. It's basically unsustainable. But we're gonna fix it. We call it death by a thousand cuts. You know, all these little tiny points of sediment add up. So to clean up abandoned mine is a long process. Essentially, when we're trying to design these stream systems, what we'll do is study an intact, healthy ecosystem and mimic that. We start with an alignment that we've engineered. An alignment is the actual shape of the river. We'll take that shape and we'll use GPS equipment to lay out the river shape on the ground. And then essentially bulldozers and excavators come in and build our river. So Nine Mile Creek used to be right here, but we rebuilt it over the course of about 6 months and added these meanders. You know, a lot of times these projects take 3-4 years to plan and finally get to this point where you get to turn the water into the river. It's a river. It's not just an idea anymore. This stuff just needs to get fixed because it's not gonna fix itself. And I guess if we don't do it, no one else is gonna do it.
So I was gonna tell you this, but there's a great backstory to that video. This is a cut from a longer video called Rewinding a River, which you should totally check out. It's really good. But so Paul was in Missoula, and there's this, I think it's called the International Wildlife Film Festival. And it's like a challenge where these people fly into Missoula and they're told to like make a movie in a week. I could be making this up. So these people fly in, these people from Los Angeles and New York, they approach Paul and they say, hey, we want you to take us out into the woods and show us about your restoration work. And Paul was like, well, you know, this is really remote backcountry. We're not gonna drive it, we're gonna have to ski. And you guys all know how to ski, right? And they're like, oh yeah, we know how to ski. And so Paul rents skis and shows up, and none of the guys have ever skied in their lives before. You know, they were in like loafers and anyway, they won an award for that video. So it's a basic fact that money flows to things that people want. And our ability to take these relatively small scale projects and bring them to scale by offering them as solutions to solving larger social problems is part of the magic of the TU story. Dutchbill Creek is a tributary to the Russian River. The Russian River has historically, it gets heavily irrigated in the summer months when the steelhead and the coho need it most. And so years ago, we came up with this innovative idea of creating these off-storage water tanks that the irrigators can fill when the river's at its highest, and then they can use that when the river's at its lowest and they need it and the fish need it the most to put on their crops. So. That's Mary Ann King, by the way, one of our great project coordinators there on the right. So we're going to be seeing a lot more of these projects because California just passed Proposition, I think it was 68. And Brian Johnson, our great California program director, had a strong hand in helping to shape the language of this ballot initiative so that it would accommodate water projects just like this one. And then our great California chapters all played a big hand and a big role in helping to advocate for passage of the measure that's going to bring about $370 million of projects like this online. You know, I hesitated to even use this picture. This is a horrible picture of the car fire, the fire that tore through Redding in July. When I started at the Forest Service, I used to work for the U.S. Forest Service about 15, 20 years ago. And when I left the Forest Service, I should say, we spent about 12 to 13% of our budget fighting fire. It's still a big number because it's a $4.5 billion agency. Today, and in recent years, they spend more than 50% of their budget fighting fire. That just speaks to the scope and the scale of the wildfire problem across the country, really, but especially in the Western United States. And what would happen historically was the agency would get its, you know, appropriation from Congress, $4.5 billion. They'd allocate it across their various programs, as they told Congress they would. And then when the fire season would start, and they quickly exhausted the fire program's budget, they'd go grab the fisheries program's budget. And then they grab the budget from the wildlife program, and then the recreation program, and the wilderness program, the forest health program. All the programs that we care about wouldn't get funded because all the money was being diverted to fighting fires. So we testified in support of a solution for this before Congress, and happily Congress listened and fixed the problem this year. So there's now a set formula for what the Forest Service fire budget should be. I won't bore you with the details. But most important, the Forest Service now can qualify for disaster funding, the same kind of funding that we use to combat or do hurricane relief or flooding relief. So these natural disasters are disasters. I mean, fire is a natural part of these ecosystems, but it shouldn't be as hot and as big as they are. So the Forest Service is now able to use funding from the natural disaster budget to pay for fire. This is a classic driftless area restoration. It's a place called Wister Creek. You can see where we peeled back the banks, put some more sinuosity back in the river, stabilized it on its points. There was some tremendous flooding in this area. I mean, tremendous flooding, like 15 inches of rain. And the project held up. Most of our restoration projects held up. This is part of about 15 miles of restoration work that we did in this past year alone. And the backstory is that in 2016, we qualified for a Farm Bill grant from something called the Regional Conservation Partnership Program. And I'm going to step back. There's a little feedback there. And we got a $2 million grant, $2.2 million grant, that we were supposed to put on the ground in projects over a five-year span. We spent it in 1 year doing projects. We came back last year, and we asked for a $9.2 million grant from the same program, and we got it. It was the second or third largest grant that they've ever given out, and you should expect to see a lot more driftless area restoration work as a result of that. This is sort of a typical example of on the left, of a perched culvert. That culvert barely passes fish, if it passes fish at all, and it will, those two pipes will plug with material, and they will blow out, and it will take the road with it. We replaced it with a bottomless arch culvert, as you can see on the right. This is an example of about 80 miles of this kind of work, 80 miles of reconnected habitat that we've done in the past few years in Michigan. The reason I'm showing this here is the administration had proposed twice now to zero out the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative budget. We use funding from that budget to do this work. And so what we did was we took these examples, just like this, and members from the Great Lakes Stakes came back and they showed their members of Congress what we were doing with this kind of funding. And they loved it. And so Congress has happily not complied with the administration's wishes, and programs like the Chesapeake Bay Fund and the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative have been fully funded by Congress. So policy can be wonky and sort of archaic and arcane and uninteresting to most people, but not if you tie it to a good story and interesting personalities. And there's a great example of that in the Calmeopsis in Oregon. The Calmeopsis is home. It's an incredibly biologically diverse area, and it's got some great rivers like the Chetco in it and the Applegate. It's just a wonderful river system. Several years ago, we were successful in working with a coalition of people to convince Congress, or I'm sorry, I take that back, to convince the Obama administration to use their authority to withdraw about 100,000 acres of this incredible landscape from entry for mining. So it's protected from hard rock mining. They want to mine nickel here for a 20-year period. So members of Congress asked the Secretary of Agriculture to rescind that, Secretary Perdue, the new secretary, newish secretary. And happily, in large part because of the story I'm about to tell you, he said that they had no interest in doing that. So this remains protected right now, and there's a good reason for that. So I'm going to absolutely embarrass Dean Finnerty, who's sitting in the front row here, but Dean Finnerty was the person that worked with us, and his job was to basically get hunters and anglers in a very rural community where people are a little bit distrustful of outsiders to support this withdrawal. And this is a very sort of resource-dependent series of communities as well. Well, Dean, his background was that he was a police officer for 26 years, and I think six of those were spent undercover doing drug enforcement work. But he has six children that he and his wife had to put through school and feed, and so he worked the night shift, and then during the day he was a guide. And he said that he told me the other day how he would always give out three or four guide trips a year to the Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation or Trout Unlimited. And after one particularly trying day at work, he came home and there was a message from TU on the phone, and the way he tells the story, his finger hovered over the delete button. And he just held it there, and he said, oh, hell. And wait until he was in better spirits, which with Dean is usually 5 minutes later, and called the TU person back, fully expecting to have yet another hand in his pocket, asking him to donate a trip. But lo and behold, that wasn't what we were calling about. We were calling to offer him a job. And so Dean became the person that helped to organize this broader coalition of people. And part of the reason that we succeeded is that, and this happens all across the organization, we have so many staff people who have these interesting backgrounds like Dean, and they are, you know, the word I guess you would use is they are embedded in their communities. They are of these communities. We're not parachuting people in from the outside and saying, hey, trust me, I'm from New Jersey, I'm here to help. In New Jersey, we'll do that, but we don't do that. We take people who are, you know, people like Dean. You know, he just described himself to me probably an hour ago now as a Christian conservative. And those are the people that you need to help move decision makers and to get people to support your way. And that's the reason why the Department of Agriculture and Secretary Perdue chose not to withdraw these protections. So several years ago, the Pennsylvania State Legislature wanted to take away the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission's authority to designate wild trout streams. We've talked about this before. It was awesome what happened next. 48 chapters in Pennsylvania, more than in any state in the union, just went to work, and they started pounding the pavement, beating the doors down of their legislators. The legislators backed away. As a result of that, we have now had a hand in designating 476 discrete stream segments as wild trout fisheries, totaling nearly 1,000 miles in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania now has over 15,000 miles of wild trout streams. This is another great TU business leader named Christopher Tobias. He's an active duty Marine stationed in Anchorage. But on the side, he's got a business where he runs a guiding service. And he has become one of our strongest advocates for voting yes on one. So we are running a ballot initiative this fall in the state of Alaska. And the initiative would simply give the state the ability to deny a mining permit to a mine that would otherwise harm anadromous fish, salmon and steelhead. For us, this is a surrogate for trying to protect Bristol Bay. And we simply could not do this work without the support of people like Dean. I meant Chris in this case. Similarly, in Montana, this is Sheep Creek. It's about 40% of the water that makes up the Smith River. It provides 40% of the flow. It's a stunning landscape. For those of you who have never floated the Smith, you've got to put it on your bucket list. It's Montana's only permit river. You have to get a permit in advance to float down it, and they're not easy to get. And it's precisely in the headwaters of Sheep Creek that a Canadian mining company wants to put a big copper mine. So we sat down with the state legislature 3 years ago and tried doggedly to get them to support a bill that would help to protect special places like this, and they ignored us. Earlier this year, we worked earnestly with the mining industry in the state of Montana to try to come to an accord to find a way to protect these really special places, and they walked away from those negotiations. So in Montana, we are also running a ballot initiative. It's called I-186, and what it would do is it would allow the state to deny a mine permit to a mine that would create perpetual pollution. So just think this through for a second. You've got a mine that, if you're lucky, will operate for 30 years and provide good family wage jobs for 30 years. And then its presence will ruin the productive capacity of that landscape in perpetuity, forever. That's all we're asking for. This could not be a more common sense ballot initiative. But we are being outspent in Alaska and Montana, probably to the tune of 6-1. Even though this is the most common sense, it wouldn't affect any existing mines. Even if existing mines wanted to expand, this wouldn't affect it. It's only for new mines. So we're being outspent 6-1, and I just realized that I'm about to ask you, I began my talk asking you to support something. I'm gonna end it asking you to support something. But I hope you will all go online and consider supporting Stand for Salmon, our Alaska ballot initiative, and Yes on I-186, our Montana ballot initiatives. These are fights that we can and we need to win. So we end where we began here, and I want to tell one story that has nothing to do with fishing and has nothing to do with conservation, but it's incredibly inspirational to me. So I know a woman who, in her late 20s, she was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis. It's a horrible disease. After she had her second child, her doctors advised her not to have any more because she might not walk again. After two more children were born, she decided to have surgery. And so they don't do this anymore, but they tried to put these implants in her hands and her feet to alleviate the pain. And the surgery didn't succeed. So she has gnarled hands and feet now. When her youngest left and went to high school, she started a business that requires her to be on her feet, you know, all day long, basically. And 30-some-odd years later, she still runs that business at the age of 81. And I think of my mother's story every time I get frustrated with the glacial pace of passing legislation in Washington, D.C., even common sense reforms like the Good Samaritan Bill, right? As we talked about yesterday, there's no constituency for acid mine drainage. Why can't we pass that bill? And I think of that story about my mother every time I start to get a little bit stressed out about the need to raise another $250,000 for Alaska and Montana in the next couple weeks for those ballot initiatives. I think about her story whenever I get a little bit despondent about how cynical our politics have become and how hard it is to get anything done in Washington, D.C. At any point in her journey, I think it would have been forgivable for my mom to become bitter or angry, cynical, and yet she is the most relentlessly optimistic person I've ever met. And if she were here in this room today, she'd be angry at me. But if she were here in the room today, she would say, Chris, or actually what she would say is, Christopher, I'm just living my life. I can hear it. I only share that story with you to encourage you never to underestimate the power of just living your life. Your stories educate and they motivate. Your stories, you're creating these models of collaboration, these models of communities coming together and solving problems. Your stories inspire hope. It is a true honor for me to be able to share these stories back with you. Let's go create some new ones.